Good evening. We are here today to discuss about a very fascinating chapter, a chapter called Chemical Equilibrium. It has something to do with chemistry, chemical, and it has something to do with equilibrium. One of the most interesting quirks of nature is that it is not always that two chemicals come together and proceed to completion. For instance, when there is an explosion, that reaction pretty much is irreversible, as are its effects. Having said that, now suppose we have, say, hydrogen gas, and we get it to react with the nitrogen gas, and we want to synthesize ammonia. For the longest time, this was a phenomenal challenge to be able to just fix nitrogen, given that today almost 75% of what we eat is definitely going to come from this one particular reaction in the form of nitrogen fixation. So that is the import of being on the right side of this chapter called Chemical Equilibrium. So what is chemical equilibrium and what happens? So we have nitrogen, we have hydrogen, and they are in a closed or sealed container, and we want them to react with each other and make as much ammonia as possible. So that is the intent. Just like I mentioned sometime back, now this reaction, like many other reactions in nature, it doesn't proceed to completion. As in, what I mean by that? What do I mean by that? So we have these two elemental gases, and we don't get the whole of them in the sealed container to convert to ammonia. Now that doesn't happen. That is just the way nature works. Yeah, there are any number of such reactions. One very famous reaction happens to be N2O4 in equilibrium with its monomer NO2. So once again, they are gases and they are in equilibrium with each other in a sealed container, of course. So to be able to synthesize ammonia, as in the first case, so we'll have to understand the dynamics of why this reaction doesn't go to completion, or put differently, we'll have to be able to synthesize as much of ammonia as possible, already given that this reaction does in fact does not go to completion whatsoever. So what are the characteristics of an equilibrium? If you observe a system in equilibrium, at the microscopic level, you'll see that the reactions are still happening. It is just that from a macroscopic perspective, the concentrations of the three different entities there, as in nitrogen, hydrogen, and ammonia, it does not change. So there is constancy of equilibrium concentrations. So from a macroscopic perspective, the concentration does not change. Also, this system at a given specific temperature, it is said to be in equilibrium. So we'll come to the mathematical part of it a little bit later, but given that this system at this moment is in equilibrium, we could approach or we could arrive at this equilibrium from either side. As in, we could start with ammonia gas, put it in a sealed container, and you will see that after some time t, the concentrations of ammonia doesn't change. And then surprisingly, you'll also have hydrogen and nitrogen in the sealed container, the concentrations of which also do not change with time. Fascinating, isn't it? Once again, the reaction has to be reversible. Yes, it can't be an irreversible reaction, and the reaction has to be in a closed vessel. It has to be a closed system. You can't constantly have matter escaping and expect the system to be in equilibrium. Further, what is the role of a catalyst? If we have catalysts in this system, it doesn't change things per se, in that it affects both the forward reaction, as in the elemental gases combining to give ammonia, as well as the backward reaction to the same extent. Also, the extent to which the catalyst affects the activation energies of either of these reactions, as in the forward reaction as well as the backward reaction, now that also remains to be to the same extent, as in it affects the forward reaction in this to the same extent as it affects the backward reaction. In other words, attainment of equilibrium could be hastened. So now that is the function of a catalyst. But it still doesn't actually change the dynamics of the equilibrium per se. We reach there fast enough, and that's all we do. Yes? Also, there is something called equilibrium constant. And this equilibrium constant, it depends only on the temperature. And at equilibrium, delta G, change in free energy, is zero. So at equilibrium, the give free energy of the system, it attains a minimum, and any change taking place at equilibrium, once again the watchword is at equilibrium, it proceeds without change in free energy. So these are the broad characteristics of a system in chemical equilibrium. Yes. Now, how did the whole thing come up? So who were the front runners? Who were the pioneers? There were two Norwegian chemists, Gullberg and Waage, and they conducted a number of experiments on a variety of systems which were in equilibrium. They came up with something called law of mass action, and it claims that the rate of a chemical reaction is proportional to the active masses of reactants. Now, this statement is the current version, and it has undergone several revisions over time. So what is the takeaway from this particular law of mass action? By the term active mass, we talk about the molar concentration, that is the number of moles per liter, or it could also refer to the partial pressure if you were to talk about a system which is completely gaseous, as in H2 plus I2, both of them gaseous, giving 2 HI, which is also gaseous. So in that case, we could actually use partial pressures. So the operative word here happens to be active mass. Now this whole scenario, the law of mass action, happens to be an empirical law, as in it doesn't have a very specific mathematical derivation. It has not been derived mathematically. What happens in nature, what happens in reality, that has been expressed mathematically. So it is the other way around. Nature expressed mathematically is law of mass action. Now, moving on to equilibrium constant expression. Sometime back, I did mention that for a given system in equilibrium, the equilibrium constant changes only with temperature. It doesn't depend on anything else, not even the presence of a catalyst. So for a general reaction, say AA plus BB giving CC plus DD, the equilibrium constant, when we express active mass in molar concentrations, then that would be KC equals concentration of C raised to its stoichiometric coefficient, which is small c, concentration of D, the whole thing multiplied by concentration of D raised to the number small d, the whole thing divided by concentration of A raised to A and concentration of B raised to B, the product of those. So this is going to be your equilibrium constant expressed in molar concentrations. So when we talk about say the formation of an ester, the formation of an ester in equilibrium, as in you have an acid, you have an alcohol forming an ester and water. So formation of ester and its opposite, as in hydrolysis of an ester. Now this system is in equilibrium. In that case, we could actually derive the equilibrium constant just the way I mentioned. Now what would happen if we were to have only gaseous reactants and products? In that case, we could of course use partial pressures. So there, instead of Kc, we would actually use an equilibrium constant called Kp, where the subscript P stands for the partial pressures. Now, if you were to keep temperature constant, the partial pressure of a gas in equilibrium mixture is directly proportional to its molar concentration, isn't it? So if you just going to, if you use PV equals nRT, and you take V to the other side, so P equals nRT by V, or N by V, which is nothing but concentration. So pressure is directly proportional to concentration, assuming temperature is constant. Also, we have fixed number of moles, at least at that given instant. So in that case, we could actually use partial pressures, and that would be a very good approximation. That could be in fact used as active mass. So that is the point I'm trying so hard to arrive at. So there is also the inevitable relationship between Kp and Kc. So you have gaseous reactants and gaseous products. So either you could use molar concentrations or you could use partial pressures. And using PV equals nRT, we just saw that partial pressures are in fact, you know, the equivalent of molar concentrations, give or take, depending on which form of the expression that we use. So we could definitely use, we could arrive at a relationship between Kc and Kp. But do note that both Kp and Kc, they give you the same information about the state of equilibrium for a given reaction at a given equilibrium temperature, is it not? So qualitatively, there is not much, that is not very much different. What information you can get from Kp, you could also very easily derive from Kc as well. So we have the inevitable expression Kp equals Kc times RT power delta N, where delta N is nothing but the total number of moles of gaseous products minus total number of moles of gaseous reactants. For the initial reaction AA plus BB giving reversibly CC plus DD, delta N would be C plus D, small c plus small d minus small a minus of small b. So that would be delta n. Now let us actually take a real example. Say you have 2 moles of nitrosyl chloride, NOCl, 2 NOCl, right left harpoons, that is a reversible symbol, and this is going to give you 2 NO, nitric oxide, which is also in gaseous state as was nitrosyl chloride, and this also gives chlorine. So you have NOCl, 2 NOCl giving 2 NO plus Cl2, all of them being gases. Now we have three different entities: nitrosyl chloride, chlorine and nitric oxide. So what kind of problem that you could expect? So definitely using the law of equilibrium constant and law of mass action, we can actually arrive at what is Kc or Kp. So either they would give you the equilibrium constant, and there are three different concentrations or partial pressures. Yes, so from them they could actually give you any two, and they could ask you to calculate the equilibrium molar concentration of one particular entity or the partial pressure, or they could give you the partial pressures of all of these, all of three different chemical species, and they could ask you to compute Kp or Kc. So that is how we deal with such problems. Now what is peculiar about equilibrium constant? Strictly speaking, in a very strictly thermodynamic definition, if you were to look at the dimensions of the quantities that we do plug into the expressions for Kp and Kc, although we use words like molar concentration or we use words like partial pressures, so we would come to expect that equilibrium constant will have some dimension if you were to look at it purely from a standpoint of dimensional analysis. However, that is not true. So since from the beginning I've been hammering the words active mass or activity, so since we are actually using activity or active mass to be able to get to equilibrium constant, although we plug in concentrations, so instead what we actually plug in these expressions are nothing but the numerical equivalents. They are not concentrations or partial pressures per se. We plug in only the numerical equivalents of those. So if it is just 0.3 atmospheres partial pressure, so we won't actually use any dimension for partial pressure or pressure per se. So even should we actually use molar concentration, once again we won't be using molars. So we will only take the numerical equivalents and plug it into the expression, so that overall the equilibrium constant itself does not contain any dimension. So that happens to be dimensionless. So that is something that we need to keep in mind. Next step, do we have any peculiarities? Say you are given a reaction, and this reaction happens to be having an equilibrium constant of K1, and they flip the reaction around, as in they give you the backwards of what was given initially and ask you to compute the equilibrium constant for the same. Then what would happen is whatever you had before, as in you had equilibrium constant of K1, in the next case for the reverse reaction it would be the reciprocal 1 by K1. The new equilibrium constant K dash will be nothing but 1 by K1. In a different problem, suppose say you are given a reaction, and this reaction is said to have an equilibrium constant of say K1 or Kc for that matter, and the same reaction is slightly altered in that if you look closely, the stoichiometric coefficients, the entire reaction, the equation, it has been multiplied by some constant C. Earlier you had the same reaction, next step you have the same reaction, except that the coefficients have been all of them multiplied by some positive number, positive whole number C. Now what would happen to the equilibrium constant? Whatever is being multiplied, the new equilibrium constant will be nothing but the old equilibrium constant raised to the number that we actually multiplied with. So these are all very standard results, and this quickly taking you through a number of standard results. Alternatively, suppose you have a big redox reaction, and that happens to be an equilibrium, and if you look closely, we figure that the whole redox reaction is nothing but it happens in three different steps. So you have the overall reaction, but you can break it down into reaction 1, 2 and 3, each one having K1, K2 and K3, and you also have the overall complete reaction. Now if you were to calculate the equilibrium constant for the overall reaction, that would be nothing but the product of K1, K2 and K3. All these things actually you could easily numerically verify once you know what law of mass action and law of equilibrium constant are. Suppose, say, you are given a generic reaction, say AA plus BB giving CC plus DD, and the temperature is constant, and they have given you the value of equilibrium constant KC. Also, they have given you what looks like the concentration of each and every one of the existing species, as in the concentration of A, B, C, and D. But you plug it into the equilibrium expression, that is for KC. KC is nothing but concentration of C to the C into concentration of D to the D, divided by concentration of A to the A, divided by concentration of B to the B. You plug in the values of these concentrations for A, B, C, and D. And you also plug in the values for small a, small b, small c, small d, everything. But you find that actually it doesn't tally with the equilibrium constant. Now, what we just computed, the elaborate expression, the value of which, now that is said to be reaction quotient Q. So does that give us any information with respect to where the system is at in terms of equilibrium? Now, if the numerical value for Q happens to exceed KC, then definitely we have more of the products and less of the reactants. And given that the system is maintained at that particular temperature T for which KC was calculated, then the reaction would proceed backwards. Now, likewise, similarly, if we compute the value of Q and it turns out to be equal to KC, then all the concentrations are nothing but equilibrium concentrations, and the system is in fact in equilibrium. And the other extreme, as in when the Q happens to be lesser than KC, in that case we see that the reactants, the concentrations of which are more than what would be ideally available at equilibrium, and hence more and more of the reactants will continue to react, and in the process they will actually end up forming more and more of the products. So the reaction quotient does give you an idea of how the system would behave, so which direction the system would proceed so as to attain equilibrium. So that is one of the major, you know, advantages of to be able to guess, given a particular temperature and concentrations, what would happen to a system. That itself is very fantastic. For reactions which have the condition where del H is not equal to zero, and the reaction in equilibrium is subjected to a change in temperature T, the equilibrium changes and also the equilibrium constant changes. So given that temperature was fixed and we had a KC or KP and that was constant, but given that del H is not equal to zero, yes, so it's either an endothermic reaction or an exothermic reaction, and we alter the temperature, we give more heat to the system, in that case definitely both the equilibrium position and the equilibrium constant in and of itself would change. Why? Because we changed the one cardinal rule that we are not supposed to play around with. We changed the temperature. So equilibrium constant definitely depends only on the temperature, isn't it? Yes. So for del H less than zero, we have an exothermic reaction. So imagine you have nitrogen and hydrogen giving us ammonia. That happens to be an exothermic reaction. In that case, if we give more heat, the system responds by moving to the direction where there would be less heat, that is towards the elemental gases. And if del H were greater than zero, the reaction is endothermic, and increasing the temperature results in shifting the equilibrium in the forward direction. Now if you were to write the equilibrium expression and figure out, all this would become very, you know, very pedestrian, very, very simple, very easy. Quantitatively, how do we assess as to what would happen to the equilibrium constant if we change the temperature? And for that, we have Van't Hoff reaction, which says that log of K2 by K1 equals del H0 multiplied by T2 minus T1 by T1 T2, the whole thing divided by 2.303 R. Now, this reaction is what would actually give us as to what would happen or how the equilibrium constant would change with temperature. So that's that. If del G naught is negative, log K must be positive and the reaction proceeds spontaneously in the forward direction. If del G naught is positive, log K must be negative and k is definitely less than 1 because log k is negative, and the reverse reaction is then spontaneous. If del g naught equals 0, log k becomes equal to 0 and k becomes equal to 1. The reaction is at equilibrium. Of course, all this comes from the computation that del g equals del naught plus RT ln k, and we equate del g to v equal to 0 and we get the Van't Hoff equation. So what is the advantage of knowing all this? What is the advantage of knowing the Van't Hoff equation? So definitely, given other variables, given other parameters, you will be able to calculate in which direction the reaction would quantitatively proceed. As in earlier, we qualitatively assessed as to what would happen to a generic reaction which was exothermic or endothermic when we raised or dropped the temperature. Now we will be able to qualitatively assess as to what would happen, by how much, what is the slope of the curve when we have log k versus 1 by t graph. So we'll be able to assess the intercept, we'll be able to calculate the slope, and we'll be able to take care of the complete dynamics of the whole of this reaction. So that is exactly the advantage of knowing the Van't Hoff equation. Last but not least, what would happen to a system which is in equilibrium should we add an inert gas? So by definition, an inert gas is not going to participate in the reaction per se. But having said that, do note that suppose say you have a hydrogen, gaseous hydrogen and gaseous iodine reacting together to give you 2HA which is also gaseous, and the system is in equilibrium, and you add some amount, say n moles of an inert gas. You can add it either at constant pressure or at constant volume, just to make the calculations easier. So in such cases, what would happen? Earlier we saw what would be the case when we have delta n, where delta n equals number of moles of gaseous products minus number of moles of gaseous reactants. So in that case, we encountered what is delta n. Now for a reaction which has delta n equal to 0, in this case for instance you have hydrogen and iodine reacting together to give 2HA, all of them are in the gaseous state. So stoichiometrically, the number of moles on the product side is 2, number of moles on the reactant side is also 2, so delta n is going to be equal to 0. In such case, it doesn't matter how you add the inert gas at constant volume or constant pressure, nothing happens, the equilibrium is not affected, nothing happens at all. And then there are those reactions where you have delta n is positive. So do keep in mind that at constant volume, irrespective of the value of delta n, nothing happens. But if delta n is positive and we add an inert gas at constant pressure, once again you can compute the whole thing analytically by means of PV equals nRT. So at constant pressure, the equilibrium shifts to the right hand side, to the products. Likewise, if delta n is negative, at constant pressure, equilibrium shifts to the left. Now all these things could be mathematically analyzed. Should we know the initial concentrations, the final concentrations and so on? Should we actually get hold of a mathematical expression and analyze the whole thing? Then definitely we'll actually be able to mathematically deduce all these things which I'm just, you know, spoofing out. So, well, that's that. Do we have any questions? Hemant is asking, what is osmosis? So he's asking what is osmosis. So once again, that is not very pertinent to our discussion right now. If you have more on chemical equilibrium, I think that would be, I don't want any ready-made questions. I don't want to be teaching you definitions to which you could just Google or take a book and you'll be able to read it out. Well, it has something to do with difference in concentrations. There is a barrier, it could be semi-permeable, and you have two. So earlier we encountered a problem where we have 2NOCl gave 2NO plus Cl2. There are three different entities, two concentrations will be given, one Kc or Kp may be given, or you might be asked to calculate Kp or Kc from some other value, and you know, using these you will be able to find out the one missing variable. So basically you will have a mathematical scenario, you will compute a few things which are already given and the one thing that is not. So that is the whole of it. That concludes this section. Don't forget, please watch our videos on the BYJUS, the learning app. Also, we have many promo videos coming up on social media as well. So watch this space.